This is your opportunity to ask questions, and I will advise you take this opportunity.
Thank you. Professor, I'd like to pose the question regarding the differentiation of a country that may pose a threat to the unity of Europe. Is that in the economics field that you mean, or regarding all the fields?
Well, you see, that's a very good question, because maybe my successor can answer it. I haven't seen yet where they think differentiation could promote unification. You see, the obvious answer should be, well, if you build a federation, there is much room for differentiation on a variety of politics on condition that you continue to agree on the basic common purposes. If there is no shared common purpose, differentiation means that one differentiates on everything where it fits the national interest, with the results that that there will be more and more divergence.
What do you think? Do you think that the United States has a big role to play in the crisis we have in Europe today?
Well, you see, let's say we all probably know that the United States, since January 20, has become the most uncertain element in international politics. I'm referring to all the executive disorders being produced in Washington these days. I don't know. All I can say is that unless Europe would quickly agree on a common defense policy, we will still have to depend on the United States. The second thing is the return to bilateralism advocated by President Trump for international trade relations is bound to bring us to a very serious international economic crisis sooner or later, as some people in the 20s of the last century already found out. So for the moment, it's better for us Europeans to act as if United States support for the time being is on hold.
Do you think Europe's role will now grow on an international level since Trump's policy is kind of against international trade and international, it's like America first, so it's going to be, do you think Europe will benefit of that?
No. Let's say Europe is not benefiting at all, because don't forget that, that's why I mentioned it rather specifically, the United States policy after the Second World War deliberately promoted multilateral trade relations as a way to promote peace and progress. European unification would not have been possible if there had not been Marshall assistance and OEEC as the organization for multilateralizing trade in Europe. When the United States today goes back to bilateralism, everybody will suffer, and Europe much more, I think, than the United States itself. United States is a big, huge market. They can allow to be unpleasant to others, but we cannot do that ourselves. So I think that if Trump does what he has promised, to go back to bilateralism, Europe will go to suffer seriously from it.
Thank you. Hi, thank you very much for that lovely overview and view into the future. If we're looking for a federal Europe and we want supranational institutions rather than summits, don't we then need the moral leadership to do it? And as we don't have the trust, seem to have the trust of the European citizens after actions of, for instance, Barroso joining Goldman Sachs after 18 months, after his 10 years as president of the EU, how are we going to convince EU citizens that they can trust their leaders if they're not shown themselves moral leaders?
In fact, you add a very important aspect to what I tried to explain you. We have, in this respect, a very serious moral crisis. And that serious moral crisis goes much deeper than the level on which I discussed it. And the only way out to some kind of federal solution means that we need to restore moral leadership. The sad thing is that moral leadership, I would think, should be coming from a profound faith in the dignity of the human person. And with all the Christians walking around in Europe, I would say there must be some people who are in a position to offer that leadership, but they keep rather silent. We are so overwhelmed by secularism and whatever it is that we have kept rather silent in our country, but in other countries as well. So I agree with your conclusion, but I don't see the leadership as yet.
Yeah, thank you very much for your great speech. Thanks a lot. Just to continue a little bit with the question that was just posed, do you think we need a kind of solidarność here in Western Europe, perhaps, to shake us up? Or is Brexit enough to bring us together? Oh, sorry.
Well, you see, whatever, let me put it this way. It's an interesting and a sad story at the same time, and Piotr would be able to tell more about it. Solidarność was, in the specific situation of Eastern Europe, Poland in the late 70s, early 80s, was a specific, brilliant moral answer on communism. They were supported, of course, by John Paul II, who was elected in 1978. So the story begins. But the sad part of it is that Solidarność, having achieved its purpose, fell apart. And you see, and maybe you will talk about, one of the saddest things I have seen in Poland, and I was there a few 2 months ago, is that those who built Polish freedom together are now fighting each other as if they are both communists from the past. I'm sorry to say it, but you know what I mean. The sad thing is that Solidarność is a beautiful example, but in very specific circumstances. But the spirit of solidarity is very important, because it is always that you make progress when you start action for somebody else, not for yourself. And I think that is the basic idea of Solidarność and of the name, was they didn't revolt because of their own bad situation. They revolted in order to be solidary, to have solidarity with others in Poland. And I think that is where Europe has failed with respect to, for instance, the refugees and the immigrants. So we have enough possibility to show the spirit of Solidarność, but it must be focused on the specific problems we have to solve. But the example is important.
Thank you. Well, maybe Can you tell us something about the relationship between Europe and Russia, and then most importantly the opportunities, maybe? We all know the threats, maybe, but there must be opportunities.
Well, how many times? You see, let me try. Well, let's say, forget about what the European Union has done with Russia in the past. That was simply building illusions. I have in my book on the history of European unification, I refer to a number of documents on the relations with Russia, and you can forget about them, it's just illusions. You see, the problem with Russia is that neither Russia understands us quite well, nor do we understand the Russians quite well. We go back to the same Jesus Christ in our history, but the schism of 1054 still troubles us in mutual understanding. We think that in order to convert Russia, they must become democracies like we are, and the Russians think that the democracy in the West and the society as it is so much diverging from what they think in their Orthodox mission is necessary, that they partly want to convert us, partly want to withdraw from us. So this double movement of withdrawal and domination is still there. The problem we have with Russia, of course, is that I love the Russian people, but they always end up with the worst possible leader. That is something. If you talk about the Russian people, I would say the more cooperation, the more dialogue as possible. But if I look at the latest leader, it's a disaster. I mean, he tells that we humiliated him. That's not true. The Soviet Union collapsed not because of us, but they collapsed because of the system. And there you have the same. Thereafter, some Russians wanted to have better contact with the West, and others, like the present one, who is dreaming of the past, like, by the way, Theresa May in her way does. The Russian leader thinks that the collapse of the Soviet Union was the greatest geopolitical disaster of the 20th century and should be restored. So he wants to restore Russia to not its Soviets, but rather its Tsarist past. So that means that part of Poland and the whole of the Baltic states and parts of Hungary, Romania, and so on, should become Russian again. That he is willing to do something about it, we have seen in the Crimea. So let's say we have a basic problem, that is that this Russian leader's view of history is just as lopsided as it is on other side with others. The second thing is that we must stick to the principle that you don't change borders in Europe by force. If change is to be made, it must to be done peacefully. So at the moment, we must confront Putin's Russia with the fact that this is not the way to cooperate. We should not be sorry that the European Union was enlarged to include Poland, the Baltic states, and the others. It is not that we wanted to come to the borders of Russia. It were you in Poland and in the Baltic states who said, please help us a little bit against the resurgent Russia. And that is a mission we took, and we should defend it. Sad thing, of course, is that defending the Baltic states still happens only when the United States takes the lead. So here we do have a problem. And I think that as Europeans, we should be much more proactive in defending the countries to which the European Union and NATO has been enlarged. So we must confront Putin in his policies and try to be remain friendly with our Russian people. I'm sorry, this is too short for such a long question, but at least.
Well, thank you, Professor Elting for Geusau.